This is a News 8 special report. 9/11. Maine remembers 10 years later.
Thank you for joining us. I'm News 8's Tracy Sable. The 10th anniversary of the September 11th attacks is just days away. It's a painful reminder of the unspeakable acts committed against our country. Nearly 3,000 people died that day. Six of them were either from Maine or had ties to the state. Over the next half hour, we'll look back on that day and the role that Maine played in the events that unfolded. The 9/11 Commission report chronicles those events in excruciating detail. Maine and the Portland Jetport are mentioned on the very first page. Although it's been 10 years, the memories and images of that day feel as if it happened just yesterday. For many, remembering isn't something that we should do. It's something we must do. On September 10, 2001, Muhammad Atta and his partner Abdulaziz Al-Omari rented a car in Boston and drove to Portland. Their plan was relatively simple. Hijack a plane and use it to kill as many Americans as possible. When they pulled into town, their first stop was the Portland Jetport.
You can pretty much tell it's a dry run. It's to take a look at what they're facing the next day.
Mike Sperry was chief of the state police at the time. He was heavily involved in the FBI investigation that would follow and saw all the surveillance video of the two terrorists caught by Jetport cameras.
You can clearly see that they were looking around at what was going on inside, what the activity was.
Sperry says Atta and Omari made it through security no problem. No one thought twice about the two men sitting with an open newspaper but studying everything around them. After a successful dry run, the two terrorists headed for their hotel just 1 mile away. They checked into the Comfort Inn but did not stay long, heading out to do some shopping. First stop, this ATM for some spending cash. Sperry and the FBI would use surveillance video from here in their investigation. Next, the two went to various stores, including this Walmart in Scarborough. Again, they were caught on tape, which would prove useful to investigators retracing their footsteps. Then it was back to the Comfort Inn, where they would spend the last night of their lives eating pizza and making phone calls. Early the next morning, the terrorists headed back to the Jetport for the second and last time. They were catching a 7 a.m. flight on U.S. Airways headed for Boston's Logan Airport. From there, they would catch the fated American Flight 11. But at the Jetport, it didn't go as smoothly as they had hoped. U.S. Airways ticket agent Mike Tuohy had the feeling that something wasn't quite right.
His eyes were dead. As you've seen his picture, there's a picture that you see everywhere. There's more life in that picture than there is in the human being that was standing in front of me. A thought registered in my head. It had never, ever done that before. It said, if this guy doesn't look like an Arab terrorist, nobody does.
Tuohy says he was supposed to give Atta and Omari their American Airlines boarding passes along with their U.S. Airways tickets. He chose not to, meaning the two men would have to go through security again in Boston. Atta was confrontational.
And he says, they said one-step check-in. And then we get into a hairy eyeball stare down. Now he's looking at me and I'm looking at him. And it's like, if you don't get upstairs right away, you're going to miss your flight. All of a sudden he said something in Arabic to the guy, to the kid standing next to him. And they, boom, turn around on their heels and they walk away. And I just go, oh, good.
Despite Mike Tuohy's misgivings, the two terrorists did make it on the plane that day. Security cameras catching their images at 5:45 in the morning. It has been asked, could something have been done differently? Could someone have stopped Muhammad Atta and Abdul Omari from getting on that plane? And even if they had been stopped, would history be any different?
You really don't know. I mean, we still would have had a major incident of proportions that we'd never really imagined before take place. They were prepared to die, and it's difficult to stop people who are prepared to die.
It's hard to believe that 10 years after those two planes brought down the Twin Towers, the remains of a 32-year-old man were just identified last month. It marked the 1,630th time a family member of someone who was murdered at the World Trade Center on 9/11 received some degree of closure. Among those who died that day were a handful of Mainers from all parts of the state. Robert Jalbert from Lewiston was on American Airlines Flight 11, which hit the World Trade Center North Tower. Robert and Jacqueline Norton, retirees from Lubeck, were on their way to California for their son's wedding. They were also on Flight 11. James Rue, an attorney from Portland and an avid mountain climber, was on his way to the Himalayas. He was on United Flight 175, which hit the South Tower of the World Trade Center. Stephen Ward, who grew up in Gorham, had just started working at Cantor Fitzgerald in the North Tower. And Commander Robert Schlegel, a career Navy man, was posted at the Pentagon. He grew up in Gray and leaves behind a wife, his parents, and two brothers. In the year after Commander Schlegel's death, his hometown of Gray dedicated a flagpole and monument in his memory. Family members say they hope the monument will keep his memory alive and inspire future generations. Air travel changed forever on 9/11, and to this day, it's one of the lasting legacies that affects us all. From long security lines and invasive scanning equipment to air marshals and reinforced cockpit doors, nothing about the way we travel will ever be the same. A little later, a look at the Portland Jetport then and now. But first, we all have strong memories about September 11th. For one Mainer, those memories go back even before the first plane hit the towers.
It made the hair on my back of my neck stand up. You could feel, it was palpable, you could feel the anger coming out of this man for some reason.
When we come back, U.S. Airways ticket agent Mike Tuohy came face to face with evil on 9/11. 10 years later, he remembers his encounter with Muhammad Atta.